السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبي وحبيبي إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الهاديين المهديين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وهل أتاك نبأ الخصم إذ تصوروا المحراب إذ دخلوا على داود ففزع منهم قالوا لا تخف خصمان بغى بعضنا على بعض فاحكم بيننا بالحق ولا تشتط واهدنا إلى سواء الصراط إن هذا أخي له 99 نعجة ولي نعجة واحدة فقال أكفلنيها وعزني في الخطاب قال لقد ظلمك بسؤال نعجتك إلى نعاجه وإن كثيرا من الخلطاء ليبغي بعضهم على بعض إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وقليل ما هم وظن داود أنما فتناه فاستغفر ربه وخر راقعا وأناب صدق الله العلي العظيم. Dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. These ayahs that I just read is from Surah As-Sad, ayah 24. And it's one of the many stories of the Quran that I want to share with you and then draw the lessons from this surah that can be a take-home message for myself and for all of us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the prophets that he mentioned in the Quran is Prophet Dawood alayhi salam. That in this surah, Surah As-Sad, ayah 24, Allah talks about this prophet and some of the incidents that happened to him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ نَبَأُ الْخَصْمِ Allah said, Ya Rasulullah, did you hear the story of those who were fighting? But the amazing is this, Allah said, وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ نَبَأُ Did the news, in Arabic, we have two words that is used for news. The first one is called khabar. Khabar means news. And the word naba also is news. But are two different. There are different between them. In Arabic, when you say al-khabar, it's a news that can be very important and it can be less important too. If a news is not important, you can say khabar. It can be important and you can say khabar too. But if a word comes, naba means that news is very important. Anytime in the Quran you see Allah say naba, then it means it's very, very important lesson. And that is why in Surah An-Naba, Allah say, Amma yatasa'alun anin naba'il azim. Allah said, they're asking about a great news. So anytime in the Quran, the word naba comes,
It's a news, but it tells you that that news is not like any other regular news. That is very important news. Here, the same thing Allah said to the Prophet, هَلْ أَتَاكَ نَبَأُ الْخَصَمَ Did you receive the news of those who were fighting? But which news? The most important news.
Who are those? And by the way, the word al-khasm in Arabic means when people are fighting. And khasm can be, it can be used for singular in Arabic, and it can be used for dual, and it can be used for plural as well. Meaning you can say al-khasm means singular, and you can say al-khasm meaning two, and you can say al-khasm meaning plural as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use it here for two. وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ نَبَأُ الْخَصْمِ إِذْ تَصَوَّرُوا الْمِحْرَابِ Allah say, have you heard the news of those people who were fighting? When they appeared, تَصَوَّرُوا, they appeared, were الْمِحْرَابِ. What's the meaning of mihrab? The word mihrab, it usually means where the imam stands to lead the prayer. And the word mihrab, the root word comes from the word harb. Harb means war. Okay, what does he mean? When imam is bleeding prayer, is he in the war? Yes. Who is he fighting? A shaitan. He's taking the responsibility of all those who are behind him and fighting shaitan. And that is why the place where imam stands is called mihrab. Means the place of war. And that is why in Islam they say when imam is praying, you are not required to read Surah Al-Fatiha or Surah because he's taking care of that. He is now battling on your behalf and fighting shaitan. And that's why it's called mihrab. Now let me share with you the brief story about what is this about. Nabi Allah, Dawood alayhi salam, he was sitting in a place which is known as like a temple. He always goes there in special time for prayers. And when he goes there, he makes sure that all the doors and windows are locked. Just time for him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody else. Just him and Allah. Now at this moment, when he was doing his prayers, then two people pops up. Just show up from nowhere. Dawood alayhi salam look at the windows and he looks at the doors. All the doors and windows were locked. How did you guys get in there? I didn't open the door and the doors were not open either. How did you get in there? So Quran says, إِذْ دَخَلُوا عَلَىٰ Dawood. When these two people entered Dawood on Dawood alayhi salam, Quran says, فَفَزِعَ مِنْهُمْ Dawood became scared. See, the prophet, they get scared too. The prophet, they are human beings like us. Certain things, they get scared. Musa alayhi salam in the Quran, when Allah told him to go to Pharaoh, he said, أَخَافُ أَن يَقْتُلُونَ I'm afraid they might kill me. I'm afraid, he said. Another ayah about Musa alayhi salam, فَخَرَجَ مِنْهَا خَائِفًا يَتَرَقَّبُ He left Egypt, but he was scared. But one thing you have to know, they get scared, but prophets are not cowards. There's a difference between these two. You get scared, but you're not cowards. The prophets and the imams, they are not that. But the prophet, they can get scared. Now here, why did he get scared? Quran said because when he was there, he was not expecting anybody. Then what happened? Suddenly these people show up. فَفَزِعَ مِنْهُمْ He came scared. قَالُوا They said to him, to Dawood alayhi salam, La takhaf. Don't get scared. Because they saw the sign. Okay, what is you? Who are you? Khasmani Bagha. They said to Dawood alayhi salam, they said, we were fighting. One of us is becoming oppressor on the other. Fahkum. Allahu Akbar. We came to you to judge, seeking justice from you because you are the prophet of Allah. Now, Dawood alayhi salam didn't ask them, what is the news? Why are you fighting? Immediately, one of them started to talk. Tell you, Dawood alayhi salam, Hada akhi. Say this, the other one, he pointed at him, he said, it's my brother. Are they from the same mother?
No.
What does he mean, my brother? Brother in humanity.
Because in Islam, we have three kinds of brotherhood and sisterhood. One brotherhood is called Al-Akhun Fid-Dam. A brother or sister, you share the same blood. And Imam Ali mentioned Najd al-Balagha. He said, a brother of you can be the one you share the same father and the mother, or a brother that you have the same father, not the same mother, or you share the same mother, different fathers. Right? It's your brother. But through blood. That is number one. Number two, there is another brotherhood, which is brotherhood in humanity. أَخُلْ لَكَ فِي الْخِلْقَ. Somebody here created human being like you. He has feelings like you. He looks like you, human being. He likes things the way you act. It's the same thing like you are. That's called a brotherhood in humanity. That's number two. Number three is called Al-Akhun Fid-Din. A brother that you share the same faith with. But out of these three, you know the most important and everlasting brotherhood is the third one. You will take the one with the blood. It's more stronger, right? No.
The strongest brotherhood that is longer and everlasting is the one that you share faith together. That Quran said, you know, when the day of judgment comes, every relationship, husband and wife, a father and a child, every relationship is ended. Except one relationship. Allah said, I'm going to keep that no matter what. What is that relationship? Allah said, two brothers or two sisters who live together and love one another and care for one another for the sake of Allah. That relationship, Allah said, I will never ever cut that relationship. Even Yawm al-Qiyamah, when a father and a son, their relationship is cut. Allah said in Surah Abbas, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. Your wife, that you share the same, you eat the same, on the same table, you do everything. Allah said that everything is cut. But the brothers or sisters who love one another, not because of business. No, we all have the same business together. No, not that one. Not because, no, we live in the same neighborhood. No, because we are all love one another for the sake of Allah. Our love is because of Allah. Allah, this brotherhood is very important, brothers. And let me even share with you an Imam Jafar al-Sadiq alayhi salam. There is one ayah in Surah An-Nisa where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, on the day of judgment, you know, one of the things that will happen on the day of judgment is that there will be a very, very hard situation. Sun will be brought all the way to the level of our heads. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, there are seven people. Seven, not more than that. Allah said, we give them a special shade of the head. And you can call them VIPs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, peace of mind, Yawm al-Qiyamah, they have shade on their heads. They ask Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, who are those seven groups, Ya Ibn Rasulullah? One وَرَجُلَانِ تَحَابَّ وَافْتَرَقَ عَلَيْهِ. Two men or two sisters who love one another for the sake of Allah and continue on that and died on that love for the sake of Allah. يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. When Allah raised them, Allah said, we will give them a shade on the day that nobody has a shade except seven people. That is the importance of brotherhood and sisterhood in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah, he said, هذا أخي له تسع وتسعون. The first guy to talk to Dawood alayhi salam, he said, Ya Dawood, this is my brother. But brotherhood in humanity. He said, he has تسع وتسعون نعجة. He has 99 sheep. وليا نعجة واحدة. And I have only one. قال, he said to me, أكفلنيها. Give me your one sheep to add to mine to make it 100 and leave you with empty 100. وعزني في الخطاب. And he said also he won. He was dominant.
I couldn't talk. I couldn't prevail. I couldn't even do anything. He said, he was prevailed. So what do you say? That is the first story Prophet Suleiman heard, right? The Prophet Dawood heard. Immediately after this story, Dawood alayhi salam said to the man, لَقَدْ ظَلَمَكَ. He has done injustice to you. بِسُؤَالِنَا أَجَتِكَ إِلَانَا. By asking you to give up your one sheep, even though he has 99, he left all the 99 to take one that you have. Dawood alayhi salam said, he has done injustice to you. And then he says, وَإِنَّ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْخُلَطَى. Most of the partners, they do a lot of injustice. You know what happened? As soon as Dawood said this, they disappeared. Now who are those two people? In tafsir, they said they were Mikael and Jibreel. Mikael and Jibreel, Allah sent them to test Dawood alayhi salam. To see how would he judge in this situation. As soon as one of them said the story, Dawood alayhi salam made a judgment. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Dawood, Ya Dawood, inna ja'alnaka khalifatan finnas. Ya Dawood, we made you to be a deputy of Allah and representative of Allah on the earth. And you're supposed to be a just ruler. A just leader. فَحْكُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ بِالْقِسْطِ. When you rule among the people, he said, make sure that you rule with the truth and the justice. Dawood alayhi salam, as soon as these two people disappeared, he realized that these were not ordinary people. So what did he do? Quran said, immediately then Dawood alayhi salam, فَاسْتَغْفَرَ رَبَّهُ. Immediately at that moment, he said, أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ وَخَرَّ رَاقِعًا. He immediately went to الرُّكُوعَ وَأَنَابَ. And he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. That is the story. Now, what is the benefit from this story? Because brothers and sisters, I want us to open our mind and our heart. That anytime to know that, anytime we read a story from the Quran, Allah doesn't present any story in the Quran unless there are a bunch of lessons from it. Anytime you read a story from the Quran, don't just think, oh, it's just a story and alhamdulillah, it's good, it's funny, it's great, and that's it. No. You know what Allah said? Allah said, we tell the best stories. نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ. We tell the best story. But at the same time, when we tell the story, Allah said, we want the story to be a lesson for you. إِنَّ لَفِي قَصَصِهِمْ لَعِبْرَةٌ. When a lesson, when we hear the story, Allah said, take a lesson from it. Now, what are the lessons we can draw from this? First, let me share with you, who is Dawood alayhi salam? Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, he was one of the prophets that Allah mentioned in the Quran. And you know, Allah have sent 124,000 prophets. Out of all this number, Allah only mentioned 25 in the Quran. Only 25, no more than that. All these numbers, 124,000, only 25 Allah mentioned. One of the 25 is Dawood alayhi salam. Dawood alayhi salam was one of the great servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the lessons I want to learn I want us to share about Dawood was that Dawood alayhi salam, you know, he lived almost more than 100 years. But you know, half of his life was fasting. Meaning, Dawood alayhi salam, his custom of his life was what? He fasts one day and then he breaks another. He fasts the next day and then he breaks another. Meaning, all his life, half of it was fasting. Most of us, when Ramadan comes, Allahu Akbar, when will Ramadan finish, right? Only one month in a year. But as soon as Ramadan comes, we're looking at when will Ramadan finish. So inshallah, we can get rid of this Ramadan because it's taking too much from us. Dawood alayhi salam, he always looking for fasting and he fast half of his life. Now, what is the significance of fasting, brothers? See, the reason why I'm emphasizing this, because one of the lessons about this prophet is
he was not eating too much. See, today, one of our biggest issues is what? Food. You want to do a gathering? The last at the end, he says, dinner will be served. That's the last thing everybody want to see. There is no dinner served. Guess what? I'm not going anywhere. It's food, everything. Mashallah, especially when we get together and we find out it's buffet. Alhamdulillah. All you can eat. Enjoy. Oh, you know what, brothers and sisters? Allah, too much food is not good for you. You know why it's not good? Because it prevents you from taqwa Allah. In other words, hunger takes you to taqwa Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hunger, it helps you to develop fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How is that? You read Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykum as-siyam, kama kutiba ala alladhina min kablikum, la'allakum tattaqoon. Allah said, we prescribe fasting upon you, maybe you might develop fear of Allah. Because in hunger, there is the taqwa Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now you practice this, brother. As soon as your stomach is full, what do you think? About Allah or bed? As soon as you fill your stomach, the brain close. Now the next thing you want is what? Where to stretch. That's all. The brain and everything, every part of your body is now blocked. But the more you're hungry, the more your brain functions. That is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, and our imams, wallah, most of their lives, they were always hungry. Read the tarikh, the history of the Battle of Ditch. The Prophet was in the hole, digging the hole with the companions. While he was in there, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was called by Asma. Ya Asma, what do you want? She said, Ya Rasulullah, I brought you food. From who? She said, from your daughter Fatima. When the Prophet looked at the food, Allah, the tears started running on his face. Why, Ya Rasulullah? The Prophet said, Wallahi, thalathata ayyam wa ma marra shay' ala fami abik. 3 days, nothing passed on the throat of your father. The Holy Prophet. 3 days, he didn't eat anything. Allahu Akbar. Yeah, why, Ya Rasulullah? You think the Prophet cannot ask Allah to give him food? Now you read in Surah Maryam. Maryam, she, Allah was sending her a food in the temple. Anna laki hadha qalatu min indillah. This is from Allah. You think Maryam is better than the Holy Prophet? Why would Allah give to Maryam but not give to the Prophet? Because the Prophet said to Imam Ali, Ya Ali, إذا وجدت الناس يتقربون إلى الله بكل أنواع التقربات فتقرب إلى الله بالجوع والعطش. The Prophet told Imam Ali, Ya Ali, if you see people are trying to get closer to Allah with different things, different ways, different methods, he said, I urge you to get closer to Allah with empty stomach and thirst. The Prophet said, فَإِنِّي وَجَدْتُ أَقْرَبُ شَيْءٍ إِلَى اللَّهِ هُوَ الْعَتَشِ وَالْجُوعِ. He said, the thing that I saw can get you closer to Allah is hunger and thirst. And Dawood alayhi salam is one of them. That one of the things he used to do, and maybe this one of the reasons what he was able to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that he always keeps his stomach what? Not full. And you go to Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He said, when you eat, he said, make sure that you divide your stomach into two. He said, half of it, let it be the food, and half of it, let it be empty. Why? He said, because these, number one, he said, it's healthier more. Number two, he said, also, فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ أَحْسَن لِلْعَقْلِ. He said, because it's good for your brain as well. That is, that's one that I want us to learn from Dawood alayhi salam. Lesson number two from Dawood alayhi salam. Dawood was known to be a one that has very, very beautiful voice of reading his book. And you know, Allah sent him a book called Zabur. Zabur was a book that was sent to Prophet Dawood. And Zabur alayhi salam, this book, Dawood alayhi salam, whenever he reads it, the narration says he has the most beautiful voice. That when he reads it, even the birds, they stop to listen to the beautiful voice of Dawood alayhi salam. And Allah mentioned in Surah As-Sad, he said, والطير يا جبال أوبي معه والطير وألنا له الحديد. Allah is asking birds that when you praise Allah, make sure that you are matching with Dawood. That is Nabi Allah Dawood. That is lesson number one. Lesson number two that I want to share with you, brothers and sisters, is that Dawood alayhi salam, Allah told us in this story that do not ever rush to judgment. A lot of us, we're always quick to judge others. I see something, somebody tell me something, immediately I judge without hearing from the other party. Somebody comes and tell you a story, this brother, this sister, he said he did. Without me waiting to hear the other side's story, I say, wallah, he's a bad guy. Wallah, he's this and this. Allah told Dawood alayhi salam, ya Dawood, that is not the proper way to go. Whatever the story might be, somebody comes and tell you a story about somebody else. One of the lessons we learned is that never, never rush to judgment just because you had one side of the story. Wait until you hear the other side of the story. Maybe it might be a different story. When you hear both of them, then you have the right to make your judgment. And that is what Allah telling Dawood alayhi salam. That Dawood alayhi salam, when he had the first story, he didn't get the chance to listen to the other. And then he made his ruling. Even though this was not wrong, what he did was right. But it's called Tark Babul Awla. Meaning, he should have listened because Dawood alayhi salam, he knew. It's ma'asum. So what he did was not wrong. Alayhi salam, he should have listened. It would have been better if he heard the other side of the story and then make his judgment. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of us, brothers and sisters, because sometimes you have children in home and you are judged as a father or a mother. Sometimes you walk in the house, your children rush to get you and say, Dad or Mom, please, brother. Immediately you get to the other side of the story. You don't hear the other side of the story. MashaAllah, you started hitting your other son, punishing, time out, and all that. Without listening to the other side of the story, Islam said that is not a good behavior of a right judge. You as a judge, as in the house, or in the family, when you hear the story, make sure that you hear both of the story before you can pass your judgment. That is lesson number two. Lesson number three, which is more important, brothers and sisters. Dawood alayhi salam, it's not like you and I. Dawood has divided his life into different situations, different categories. You and I, most of our time is for what? It's for job. And time for Allah is the shortest time. When our time comes to give to Allah, it's like 2-5 minutes, we're rushing. Dawood alayhi salam, he divided his life into different categories. As a matter of fact, the narration says he divided his life into five. And I want all of us tonight, brothers and sisters, please let's divide our life like Dawood alayhi salam. He divided his 24 hours a day, he divided into five. Number one, sa'atun lillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Out of 25, he divided there is time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Time that when that time comes, nobody intervene in that time. If time is just for Allah. No human being. Nobody comes in that time. At that time, it's just dedicated to Allah. Nobody else. That's number one. Number two, sa'atun li ashabi. Time for his companions, where he teach them. He goes to their weddings. He participates in the funerals.
He goes to visit somebody who is sick. Time for other people, his companions, his community. That's number two. Number three,
وَسَاعَةٌ لِأَهْلِ.
Time for his family, wife and children. That's number three. At that time, no companions is involved. Allah is not here. No, this is just for my family, my wife and children. We sit down, we talk, we play, we joke around. That time is just for Allah, for my family.
That is number three. Number four, وَسَاعَةٌ لِمَعَاشِ.
Time for job. That I leave home to go and search for my daily bread. I come home, take care of my family. Number five, سَاعَةٌ لِنَفْسِ. A time for just myself. No Allah, no companions, no wife and children. Nothing is for me to rest and sleep and take rest.
That's the five times. Five different times a person is supposed to divide. Now, unfortunately, in this country, our time is our life is divided into two. Right? One is job, one is for ourselves. For Allah, maybe 5 minutes and see us when we come to pray, mashallah. It's like somebody is on the gun with us. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Sadaqallah, I'm gone. Most of our time is for what? It's for a job. Now, I can spend two jobs, three jobs, from here to there, from there to there. I'm running. But I don't have time for Allah. Where is time for Allah, brothers? Where is time for my family? Unfortunately, sometimes we don't even have time for our families. Because it's all work, 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 work. Sometimes some sisters, as the opposite, I don't have time for my husband. Because it's always work. Two jobs, from one job to another, from one to another. I come home, I'm tired, I'm gone. At the morning, it's like robot. No time for my wife, no time for Allah. No time for anybody except job, job.
Brothers, we have to pause it at somewhere. Please. Life is not always about job. There should be time for Allah. Allah gave you 24 hours. At least dedicate 2 hours for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 2 hours. Say, this is just for Allah. And this for Allah is for your akhirah too. When you say this is for Allah, meaning I'm preparing for my akhirah. But this job is nothing for dunya, brothers. And whatever the dunya is going to be left here. You can work as hard as you want. But at the end of the day, it should be left here. But the time that you give for Allah is what will remain on there in that world. وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. That is the everlasting. That is what we need to work for, brothers and sisters. That is what our time is supposed to be given. Our attention should be given more than this world. I'm not saying forget about this world. No, give it a time. But don't let all be for this and forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes we give more time for job that we forget our own children. We don't have time for them. And then suddenly when something happened to our children, we say, oh, what happened? Allahu Akbar. I didn't do anything wrong. Yes, you did everything wrong. You have to have time for families, brothers and sisters. Time for our children. We sit with them. We talk with them. We ask them questions. See who they hang around with. Who do they go with? Who do they talk to? What is happening in there? You have to be involved, brothers and sisters. Because this is also another responsibility Allah put on our shoulders. Yawm al-Qiyamah, whether you like it or you don't, you have to answer Allah subhanahu. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nara. Yawm al-qiyamah, none of us will pass the sirat unless we answer Allah about those children that Allah gave. How did you treat them? How did you raise them? Did I let daycare to raise them? Like in the morning, I drop them at the daycare, I pick them at the daycare, we feed them, go to bed. That's like somebody is now taking care of my children. Who am I? Am I a dad? Or am I a mom? Who am I? Dawood alayhi salam, he divided his time into five. And the same thing applies to our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That the narration says, one day the Prophet was out. Three companions came to the house of the Prophet. And they met Umm Salama. They said, Ya Umm Salama, we came to ask about the Prophet.
inside house life. How does he live with you? We know him outside when he meet with us. We know him that. But we don't know how is he at home. Umm Salama said, what can I tell you about dear Prophet? He said, Rasulullah, he was khaluq, very kind, gentle at home. He prays, he fasts. And as she goes to tell them, well, he fast? I said, yes. One of them said, Allah Akbar, if this is the Holy Prophet, he is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guaranteed heaven. And he fasts every Mondays and Thursday. He said, from today, I'm going to start fasting until the day I die. The other one said, what else does he do? The Umm Salama said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always reads Quran. The other one said, if that's the case, this is the Prophet, I'm going to start reading Quran every single day until the day I die. The other one, he said, what else does he do? They said, the Prophet always prays at night, Salat al-Layl. He stands on his feet all night long. The other one said, if that is the Holy Prophet, who am I? Then I have to start doing my Salat al-Layl every night. And then they left. Everybody took something with him. The Prophet came home. Umm Salama said, Ya Rasulullah, some of your companions came and they asked about your private life. And this is what I told them and this is what they said. You know what the Prophet did? The Prophet immediately became so angry. He went to the masjid and he called everybody to come to the masjid. They gathered the companions. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I heard that some of you came to my house today. And you asked about my private life and you were told, and this is what you say, this is what somebody said. And I'm here to tell you that all this is wrong and false. You shouldn't do that. What do you mean, Ya Rasulullah? We shouldn't pray at night. He said, you should. He said, but you have to divide your life into five. You cannot read Quran all night long and then forget your family. No, Allah doesn't want that. Because remember, your family is one of your responsibilities too. You cannot go and say, I'm going to fast all the time and then forget to go to job. Because taking care of your responsibility, paying the bills is your job too. It's one of the wajibat too. As you cannot say that, I'm going to take care of the job and forget about my wife and children and salah, because each one of them is your responsibilities. The way you have to take care of every one of these, you have to take care of the others too. So it all comes as a package. So the take-home message, my dear brothers and sisters, when we leave tonight, brothers, let's make our own schedule to divide our time five. Time, remember time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you have 10 minutes for Allah, or every day, let's say 25 minutes you have for Allah, right? Fajr 5 minutes, Zuhr 5 minutes, Maghrib Asr 5 minutes, Maghrib 5 minutes, Isha 5, 25, right? Please make it 35. Add some more time. And gradually increase as you go from 5 to 10, 10 to 15. Make it an hour, or at least when you can come, and make every single day of your life becomes just for Allah. Like Ibrahim al-Khalil. Qul inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati. Ibrahim said, my entire life is given to Allah. And wallah, we all can do that. Well, your 24 hours is for Allah. How can you do that? Here's the tip. When you go into job, Allah, make your niyyah. I'm going to job qurbatan ilallah. Wallah, automatically it becomes for Allah. It's like you are now on the clock with Allah. Huh? You are with the clock with your company, and at the same time, you will be put on the clock with Allah. That every minute you spend at work, it's like you're doing ibadah, because you say you do it for the sake of Allah. You want to spend time with your family? Say, I'm spending time with my family qurbatan ilallah. Wallah, they put you on the clock, huh? The angels, they're writing. Every minute you spend with your family is being rewarded for. When you want to go to sleep, say, I'm going to sleep qurbatan ilallah ta'ala. You get rewarded for your sleeping as well. You want to go visit a sister, a brother, say, I'm going to visit the qurbatan ilallah ta'ala. You'll get reward for every step that you take to visit them. For every minute you spend with them, you get rewarded for that. If you do that, your 24 hours becomes what? Qurbatan ilallah ta'ala. And then you become like Ibrahim, where he say, mahayaya wa mamati. Your life becomes qurbatan ilallah.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to do so, Ya Rabb al-Alim.
Ya Allah, help us to make our lives as better servant of yours, Ya Rabb al-Alim. Day in and day out, Ya Allah, help us to become better and better servant of yours, Ya Rabb al-Alim.
Ya Allah, we ask you, help us to fight our shaitan on daily basis, Ya Rabb al-Alim. والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآل محمد Now we go to question and answers. Yes. عليكم السلام ورحمة الله. Yes.
Before I answer the question, let me define what the ghibah is. Then if we define it, then you can apply it anywhere. If it matches that category, then it's ghibah. If it doesn't, then you're good. The definition our scholars gave for backbiting is that ذِكْرُ أَخَاكَ فِي غَيْبَتِهِ بِمَا يَكْرَهُ. To mention or to talk behind a brother or a sister about something about him that if he is to be present, he will not be happy about it. If he is present, whatever I'm talking about him, if he happened to be present, he will not be happy about it. That is called ghibah. Now, with the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, it is, number one, it's our responsibility that before we quote something about them, we have to make sure that it's authentic and true. But you know that if you fail and you say something about them and it's not true, and you know that it's not true, and you say that to Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, you get a very big sin. And if it's in the month of Ramadan, your fast is void. In the month of Ramadan, I'm fasting. Why do you fast? I ascribe and lie openly and then say, oh, Imam Jafar al-Sadiq said, oh, Imam Hassan al-Askari said, knowing that it's not true, then your fast is absolutely void. That is something that we have to be careful. That is dapa. But if something that I heard, and I heard from somebody who is maybe reliable source, or I heard from somebody, and I know that it's authentic, because it doesn't matter, Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, they encourage us to share their knowledge with the people. Imam al-Radha alayhi salam, what did he say? He said, حَدِّثُ النَّاسَ مَحَاسِنَ كَلَامِنَا. He said, talk to people about our eloquent words. فَإِنَّ النَّاسَ لَوْ عَرَفُونَا لَتَّبَعُونَا. So the people, if they don't know our beautiful words, he said, they would definitely follow us. Definitely. The problem is us. We don't get to the people. We always try, mashallah, in our club, that's where we start. We don't get out of our club to go and call others. And I remember one young man in Tampa, in the masjid, one day he came and he was looking at me like, he's a strange guy, what are you doing here? His face doesn't look like somebody who comes to the masjid. It's like typical non-Muslim. And we thought, what are you doing here? He said, I'm here to do my salat. I said, okay, go ahead, do your salat. He finishes salat, says, salam alaikum, where are you from? He said, I'm here from Tampa. Really? What are you doing? When did he become Muslim? He said, a few years ago, I became a Muslim. How? Now, listen to his story. How did he become Muslim? He said, one day I went to the bookstore. I was looking books. And as I was looking, I suddenly came to Islamic section. I was looking, and I saw one book called Dua Kumail. I said, Dua Kumail? Who is Kumail? He said, I took the book out, and I was reading the translation. He said, I get to the part where Imam Ali was saying, فَلَئِن تَرَكْتَنِي نَاطِقًا لَأَدْجَنَّ إِلَيْكَ. He said, if Allah is to let me to speak, I will scream and cry.
like a baby who lost their mother. He said, I was reading the, I don't know where the tears started coming on my face. He said, what kind of book is this? He said, I closed it. I bought it though. I went home, I left it for 1 week. After a week, I said, let me read it again. He said, I took the book. As I started reading from the beginning, he said, I get to the middle where Imam Ali said, Elahi manli ghayrak. Oh my Lord, who do I have more than you? I have nobody. He said, when I get there, I started weeping too. I said, what is this book? It's getting me to cry this so bad. I don't know who is the man, who is the author, but I know that he's saying something that can get to my heart. Then he started to research about Imam Ali, about Dua Kumail. He said that Dua Kumail got him to turn to become a Muslim. Dua Kumail, the beauty and eloquent words of Adil Bayt Ali himself. If we are to get to this voice to people, trust me, the world is different, will be different. So if you get a chance to quote one hadith, one ayah, one saying of Imam to anybody, please do so. But if you know that it's authentic, absolutely you get rewarded for it. And there's nothing called ghaiba in this, inshallah. Yes. 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 Yes.
Sister's asking, last week we talked about the punishment of Isra and Mi'raj. That certain people, the Prophet, when he was given a tour, that he was shown the hellfire, the heaven, and the people, and the punishment, different stages. And part of what he was shown was the people that the Prophet saw, they were hanged by their tongue. And the Prophet asked Jibreel, Ya Jibreel, what is this? Why are they being punished this way? Then Jibreel says, because of their backbiting. They used to backbite, Ya Rasulullah. So the question sister is asking is that people are supposed to be punished Yawm al-Qiyamah. And when the Prophet went there, there was no Qiyamah yet. So what is it? The answer is that, see, we have two kinds of Qiyamah. When you go to our scholars, there is one is called Qiyamah Sughra, minor Qiyamah. And the other one is called Qiyamah Al-Kubra, the major Qiyamah. Qiyamah Sughra, when does it start? They say it starts right at the time of death. Right at the time of death, as the Qiyamah of person started. That's what the Prophet says, إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمْ قَامَتْ قِيَامَتُ. When a son of Adam dies, his Qiyamah has begun. That's that. At that moment, his Qiyamah started. Meaning, if he's going to hell or heaven, it's right there he knows. So the Qiyamah started. But which Qiyamah is that? The Qiyamah Sughra. So that these people, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he was shown, yes, they were in the Alam al-Barzakh, but their image was shown in Alam al- in the seventh heaven, where the Prophet saw it. They were here in the barzakh. They were being punished in this world. But you know what? You know that in this world, we have our bodies is here, but we have image in the seventh heaven. Every one of us, we have image there. Some narration said, you know, when we commit sin, anytime we commit sin, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have like this TV, right? You see this TV? Or there's a TV like that. That every one of us, all the creatures, the image shows up there. As soon as you do a sin, the angel will be like, look. Oh, auzubillah. But you know what Allah does? You know what Allah does? When we sin, then Allah turns off the light on us so they cannot see us. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because Allah want to protect you. You know, in Dua Kumail, you know what Imam Ali says? كَمْ مِنْ قَبِيحٍ سَتَرْتَ. How many bad things you covered, you? You didn't sin. You disobeyed Allah. But Allah said, I still want to cover you. I don't want the angels to see you to say bad things about you. In one dua, we say, يَا مَنْ سَتَرَ الْقَبِيحِ وَظَهَرَ الْجَمِيلِ.
He who covers the bad and uncovers the good. Your good,
Allah shows to others.
Your bad,
Allah says, I want to cover it.
So those are images of us. Yawm al-Qiyamah, when somebody dies, those images, it shows in the heaven. But that image is not like image of what will happen on the about the day of judgment. It's just like a photo or the image of people who have been punished in this world, that their image was shown to the Prophet.
But the true and the hellfire will be on the day of judgment and Yawm al-Qiyamah. Yes. Yes. Alaykum as-salam. Yes, the hadith is authentic. Yes, mentioned that Imam Ali says, لا تربوا أطفالكم كما ربيتم فإنكم خلقتم لزمان وخلقوا لزمان. That's the hadith. That Imam Ali said, do not raise your child the way you were raised, because you were created for a certain time and they were created for a certain time. You know what Imam Ali means? It doesn't mean that, okay, I was created and I was taught to do namaz, so I'm not going to let you do namaz. No, that's not what he meant. What Imam Ali alayhi salam meant is that there are certain things in life that you were deprived from because of your time. Like my time or our time, inshallah, there was no computers. When you, most of us were growing, there was no computer. Your dad, there's nothing called even computer. Now the time is the time of computer. So should I say because of my time when my dad was raising me, we didn't even know what the computer, so you're not supposed to get it too. No. Imam Ali said, your time, the technology was not that spread. And now it is, so do not deprive your child from it. That is this kind of things that Imam Ali is talking about. And the same thing like you said, maybe the time that I was born, the community that I was raised, is very safe to walk from one place to another. That all the neighborhoods, they watch for one another. But now you live in a society where no, everybody said that, you know, why should I bother? It's not my business. So here, I cannot let my child go to the bus stop by themselves unless there is an adult with them. Yes. So what Imam Ali is saying is about this, is that yes, if there are certain things that you did not obtain because of certain reason, or you obtained because of certain reason, and your child could not because of another reason, yes, that's exactly what he's supposed to do. Yes, so you know you should not treat your child exactly the way you were treated because your time is different than your child's time. Like for example, I'll give you an example. And I know most of you are the same. When we were growing up, when your dad said, sit down. That's it. You sit down and you're quiet. Right? Now you ask your child, sit down, I'm going to ask you why. Tell him go to bed. You say, why? Everything you have to answer a question. And you cannot say, why are you asking me why? I never asked my dad. Okay, that's you. But now they have to ask. And you have to give an answer. Right? Let's get, why do you have to go to bed? Because tomorrow you have to go to school. And you need to rest so that you can wake up early. Yes. So that is our time, and that is their time. We cannot compare them, both of the time together. And that is exactly what Imam Ali alayhi salam is talking about. Yes. Yes. Yes, this hadith is absolutely authentic. Yes. And it's mentioned in Mafatil Jinan too. That Imam Ali alayhi salam says, Alamat al Mu'min Khamsa. That the sign of a mu'min, a true mu'min, a Shia, a follower of Ahlul Bayt, you can define him with the five characters. And this is not just Imam Ali alayhi salam. We have the same hadith was quoted by Imam Jafar al Sadiq. We have other Imams who say the same thing too. They ask Imam, what are the five things? What are the those five qualities? Number one, he say, al-jahru bi-bismillah. A mu'min, when he prays, he always says Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim out loud. Like we say in Salat al-Dhuhr and Asr, that is one sign of the Shia, true Shia of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam. Number two, at-ta'fir bil-jabin. Meaning, doing sajda on the turba or on the earth. That is the second thing, that is the sign of the mu'min. Number three, at-takhattum bil-yameen. Wearing a ring in the right hand, right finger. That is one of the sign of a mu'min. Number four, yes. Number three is wearing ring in the right hand, right finger. Because it's known that Bani Umayyah, they used to wear in the left. Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they always encourage to wear in the right. That way you tell who's Shia or who's not a Shia. But if you have one in right, you can wear in the left. But if you don't have one, if you just have one, then you should put it in the right. If you have one already in the right, you want to wear in the left, that's fine. But right should be the first one to wear a ring on. That is number three. And number four. Number four, they say, well, 50 raka'ah. 50 raka'ah a day. 51, I'm sorry. Yes, 51 raka'ah a day. Now, how is 51? You say, mashallah, this is like we're not going to go to job today. No, you can't. 51 raka'ah a day. It's like, then we have to call in today. No, you can't. What are the 51? Number one, Salat al-Layl, 11 raka'ah right there. Right? At night, and you get a chance, and it's one of the important salah. Number two, your 5 daily prayers included, which is 17 raka'ah in combined. Fajr, Zuhur, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, combined is 17 raka'ah. Now you add 17 plus 11. Then you have nawafil of the day. Fajr prayer, there is 2 raka'ah before the Fajr salah. Okay, that is number one. Then you come to the Fajr al-Dhuhr prayer. Al-Dhuhr prayer, there is 8 raka'ah prayer. 4 raka'ah before and 4 raka'ah after Dhuhr prayer. If you can, if you cannot, you can do 1-4 raka'ah, that's fine. If you cannot, just 2 raka'ah is enough. But if you want to follow the full practice of Imam, 4 before and 4 after. Then you come to the Asr prayer, also 4 rak'ah before the Dhuhr, 4 rak'ah after 4 rak'ah before the Asr, and 4 rak'ah after Asr prayer. Then after that you go to the Maghrib. Maghrib, there is 6 rak'ah. 6 rak'ah, you do 2-2-2. Without the taslim, you do Allahu Akbar. After the Maghrib, you stand up and you do 2 rak'ah. In the first rak'ah, you read Qul ya ayyuhal kafirun. In the second rak'ah, you read Surah al-Tawheed. And after you say the taslim, you don't talk. You stand up again and you bring another 2 rak'ah as well with the taslim. After these 4, then you do another 2 rak'ah, which is called Salatul Ghufayla. But you read, وَظَنُّونِ إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا فَظَنَّ عَلَّا نَقْدِرْ عَلَيْهِ فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَنْ لَا إِلَّا إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And then the next ayah, the next rak'ah, you read, وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّا هُوَ, to the end of the ayah. That is the 6 rak'ah of the Maghrib. Then after that, there is 2 rak'ah for Isha, which you can do it by sitting, or you can do it by standing. But the narration says it's better to do it sitting after the Salat al-Isha. These combined, they say it will become 51 rak'ah that Imam is talking about. That if one can practice this on daily basis, inshallah, you will consider one of the mu'mineen. Yes. 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 No. The Salat al-Ghufayla, yes, it's not considered part of it. But it's one of the recommendations too. Yes, you can. Because actually the Maghrib rak'ah is 4. But they said the Salatul Ghafil is mustahab. The other 4 that I mentioned, you read in the first rak'ah, Qul ya'ayyuhal kafirun, and then the next one is Qul huwas Surah at-Tawheed, and then the other 2 rak'ah, they say you read the surah of your choice. right? But then Salatul Ghufala is just mustahab that one should read. But it's not considered one of the 51 rak'ah, but it's recommended. Al-Ghufayla from the Ghafla. Ghafla means, because usually, when people go and pray the Maghrib, they used to separate at the time of the Prophet. So after the Salat al-Maghrib, people go and they take a nap. Some of them, by the time they wake up, Salat al-Isha, Jama'ah is already gone. So Ghufayla comes from the word Ghafla, the time that people forget. Meaning, so Salat al-Ghufayla means the salat of forgetfulness, meaning the time that people normally forget, you stand to perform this salat to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is what the meaning of salat al-ghufayla, that the time that people normally take for resting and to sleeping, you take that time to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the meaning of ghufayla. Yes. 2:22, yes. It's between Maghrib and Isha, yes. No, it's compared to 2 rak'ah. Now, which one? No, you do 2 rak'ah. You do 2 rak'ah by sitting, and it's considered 2 rak'ah. Mm-hmm. No. I thought the other 2 of Ghufayla is not counted as part of it. Which one? The reward of it, yes, but it's 2. I thought you were talking about it's 1 rak'ah. No, it's 2 rak'ah you perform, but you get the reward of 2 rak'ah, but it's counted as 1. Yes, absolutely. I thought you said it's 1 rak'ah. No, it's 2 rak'ah, but it's counted as 1. Yes. After the Isha, yes. Always after Isha, yes. Yes. Yes, of course. You know, people cannot leave a mustahabbat, wajibat, and get busy with the mustahabbat. No. You know, even in the fiqh, they said, if your mustahab will affect your wajib, don't do the mustahab. For example, if I am to wake up and do the namaz shab, but then I might not be able to do fajr on time, they say, forget about the namaz shab and wake up on time to do your wajib prayer, which is Salat al-Fajr. So the ultimate important prayer is the wajibat first. Then after that, you do the mustahabbat. Yes. It's like I owe the bank and then I go giving charity. Well, bank is still, I owe bank like thousands of dollars. No, Islam says pay your debt first, and then you can give a charity later if you have one. But don't give debt, don't be giving charity when you owe somebody else. So yes, you owe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qada, that should be taken care of first, and then after that, mustahabbat comes after that. Inshallah. I think, okay, good, last question. It's a good question. How do we know that our qada is done? Here, in the fiqh, they say, if you can estimate, like say, I think it's 10 years salat. For example, inshallah, nobody have 10 years to salat. Let's say, I think it's 1 year, for example, then that is what you have to do, right? Whatever you think is you owe Allah, that is your wajib. But if you don't know, I can't even remember, right? They say, keep paying and pay and pay and pay until you get satisfied that now I think I'm done with it. Then you can stop at that point. Until you feel that now I have paid Allah all my salat, all my qada, then you can stop. But until that, if you not get to that level of satisfaction, then you have to keep paying and paying until that point comes up, inshallah. Yes.
It's actually wajib upon the oldest son, if there is. However, if the father or the owner or the parent, what they can do, they can write in their will that I owe this amount of prayers or fasting or hajj or whatever wajib it is, but I don't want to put burden on my children, so I want them to take from 1/3. Because when a person is dying, automatically Islam divides their wealth into 3. Automatically, whether they like it or not, Islam says, I'm doing this. That's it. 1/3, Islam says, is for you, the deceased. Whatever you want to, Islam says, you can write. You want to give somebody free, you want them to do something, anything you want, you say, you can write from that 1/3. But 2/3, Islam says, you cannot touch that. That's for your family and your people, your loved ones after your death. And that 1/3, if you are smart, he is smart, huh? If you are smart and you write in your will that, okay, this 1/3 that I have, if you guys don't want to do it, you have to hire somebody to do it on my behalf. Then they are responsible to hire somebody to do it, whether they like it or not. But if you don't put it in your will, guess what? Islam says, now it's your choice. You want to hire somebody, fine. You don't want to, if the money is yours, whatever you want to do with it. If they don't do it, it's up to them. If they want to, it's absolutely their choice. So Islam gave you that chance. It's either use it or lose it. At that moment, if you use it, then they have no choice to do it. After your death, they have to do it. But if you don't, then it's up to them. So yes, if there is any prayers that is not performed by the father, it's absolutely wajib upon the older child. But if the other children, the older child say, I'm not going to do it or didn't do it, the others can voluntarily do it on behalf of their parent, and that will be sufficient too. Yes. No. There is no istighfar for prayer. The only istighfar we can do it for not performing that salah, and then we have to go and perform the salah. I say astaghfirullah, because when you go to the Najil Balagha, Imam Ali, that's what he said. When he saw a man, he did all kind of haram, haqqun nas, didn't pray, didn't do anything. And then he has a long tasbah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Imam Ali said, are you kidding me? In today's words, though, he didn't say I kidding. In just today's word, I'm putting it. You know? That, what are you doing? He said, I'm doing istighfar for my sin, for my haqqunnah. Imam Ali said, no, it doesn't work that way, brother. It's istighfar is 6 conditions. One condition is you regret about the bad deeds. And then 2, you make intention not to perform that bad deeds anymore. And then you go to, and then he said, and then you have to return all the bad deeds, all the rights of the people. And then you have to perform all the missing wajib. All of them. So if I want to do istighfar, yes, I can do istighfar. But then still after that, I have to go and pay all those wajibat that I miss, inshallah. Yes. 1 minute.